Hi, artsy friends. I'm Tristina Dietz-Elms, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to make an artist trading card. I enjoy making them in different techniques. In this particular video, we're going to talk about working with permanent Bombay inks and collage. If you like this kind of video, I hope you'll subscribe and give it a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Let's get going. Here are my Bombay inks. They are permanent when they're dry, which is what I love about them. And they're perfect for various types of mixed media. Now off to the side here, I also have some of the iridescence. In this case, it's a bronze, and I love my nickel. And those are gonna give us some sparkly effects when we start working with them. This is the Bombay India ink set number 2. There is also a set number 1, but I really like these colors here, which you can see we have golden yellow, yellow ochre, orange. Now there's an orange and a tangerine, which look like they're close to each other, but in fact, the orange is much thicker than the tangerine. And so it has more of an opaque coverage. The tangerine is much more transparent. There's a terracotta, which is very opaque, cherry red, crimson. I think crimson's probably one of my favorite colors. It's also a good mixing color if you want a nice deep purple. A red violet, Van Dyke brown, one of my favorite browns, especially if you're going to do something like pine trees or something like that. I love the Van Dyke brown. Sepia, which is super dark. You can see it's almost black, but not quite. It's a little bit brown. Turquoise, love this color. Oh my gosh, I love mixing my greens with turquoise instead of mixing them with a cyan or an ultramarine. I love bright high key colors, and turquoise mixes beautiful colors. And then the aqua, which is like a teal. These two are nice and transparent, and I love working with them in mixes for that reason. Here are some examples of some cards that I've made. They're not complete. This one, I would say, is complete and ready, but these need a little bit more work, and they use these paints that I had shown you just a moment ago, the Doc P.H. Martin paints. But I wanted to show you some of the options for the types of surfaces that you can use. This is called an artist trading card. They're also called ACEOs. That means artist cards, editions, and originals. So these are originals. They are the size of a baseball card or a Pokemon card or any other kind of collectible trade card. What I like to do is I like to store these in the same kind of sleeves that you would store a baseball card in or some sort of trading card. And the surfaces are not just watercolor paper like these, but this is by Art Alternatives, and it's a little canvas paper pad. Then we have Legion has these beautiful papers, and they're in this small size as well. This one happens to be craft paper. So you can see I started a piece here, and I love this craft color. You know, you can really actually just cut up a paper bag. So if you go to the grocery store and you ask them to put your items in a brown bag, you can literally cut up that brown bag and use it. Now, this is acid-free archival paper. That's the difference here. These are super cute. They're ink essentials, and they are, again, you just look for artist trading cards. These are manila style. So I love the manila. They are by Ranger. And then also, they make these in black. Now, the Legion also makes black. Actually, they make a black watercolor paper, which is beautiful. But you can imagine your sparkly paints or some of your beautiful white markers will work really nicely on the black. And then Strathmore is another company that has the many different kinds of surfaces. They have the black as well. And this happens to be a set of textured. So let me pull these out here. And so the surface has a little bit of texture to it. And so I'm going to be starting one of these with you. And another cool thing that Strathmore has is they have little white envelopes. So if you were to sell these, again, and when you sell them, they're an ACEO or an artist card editions and originals. And here's a little envelope that you could put it in like this before you send it out to somebody. So that's a nice protection. If you have a stack of them, you can put a whole stack in one of those envelopes. Okay, so we are going to work with that Strathmore paper and the crimson and the turquoise Bombay inks. And I just have a Pebbio small brush here that I'm going to dip into my water just to get the tip juiced up. And I'm going to be using what's called a slant palette. And I'll put a little bit of the ink in here. Usually I do shake it because depending on how thick the paint is, I had shown you earlier the orange is very thick. And so a color like that needs to be shaken up. These have beautiful droppers in them. So we're working on a very small space. So I'm going to only put a tiny bit of the crimson out there. And then here is, I was telling you, my favorite turquoise. And I'm going to put a little bit of the turquoise in there also. Let's pick up some color and just put it on here. Now, one of the things I do before I actually pick out my colors of paint is that I pick out some of my collage elements. In particular, I pick out my postage stamps. I have a whole collection of international postage stamps. So I look at the stamps and get an idea of what stamps I might want to use on this particular piece. And that helps to guide me in what colors I select before I get started. So these are a couple of the ones that I might use, but I'm going to move them out of the way because I don't want paint splashing onto them unless I want it to, right? Let's take a look at this crimson. Beautiful. There you go. And then I'm going to put a little bit of the turquoise on the same brush with the crimson. And let's blend it a little bit here. You're going to see a nice purpley color come up. And the nice thing about using two colors like this and then mixing other colors is that you know those colors are going to play well with each other. So let's put some, and I'm doing a very sort of random here. And so I'm going to put in just sort of some shadows because I'm putting a little bit more water on my brush to be able to get the paint to come off. I'm going to do some little flowers with this red and just do something sort of fun there. I'm noticing that this paper, the ink really soaks in quickly. And now I'm dipping it in water. Let's come in with some of the turquoise. Actually, I'm going to put a lot of water on it. So what I have when I want to water down my colors is I have a dropper like this and I pick up some water and I put a couple drops in there. And the reason for that is these paints are very concentrated. So even with a bunch of drops of water and one drop of paint, you're going to see that it really holds a lot of color, doesn't it? Now, what if I wanted to get a little bit of green in there? All I need to do is pop in a little bit of yellow. This is just creating a background. It doesn't have to be perfect. That's the beautiful thing about it being an artist card, right? Is the fact that we can make it our own. It just shows the hand of the artist here creating these marks. And of course, I can go back over it later as well. Now, let me grab a little paper towel here. Normally, before I rinse off my brush, I get as much paint out of it as I can there. And then I dip it into my water. And then I'm constantly dipping it in the water and brushing it up so that I can get and brushing it on my paper towel so that I can get as much color off as possible before actually swishing it around in the water. That way, my water will stay rather clear for quite a long time. And I love that. Now, let me get a little bit of yellow so you can see how we can get a vibrant green. I am going to shake this. And here we go. We're going to get an amazing green going here by picking up just a little bit of this diluted turquoise and then mixing it with that yellow. Look at how quickly I get like a really cool looking green. Wow. Okay, so I'm just going to put random little leaves in here. I'm just doing something similar to what might be a plant of some sort. Now, if you really want to get, if you really want to do a lot of planning ahead, you can take the stamp that you think you're going to put on there, and then you can audition it with the background that you're creating. So let's audition this, and there's a nice pattern that's coming out from behind there. What about the other one that I had here? That one covers up a lot of it, but then if you put it down here, it doesn't cover up a lot of it. So you, as I said, you're going to sit there and audition it. And let me put a little bit more yellow here because I'm going to cover some of the background with yellow. And I'm going to get my brush a little bit wet. And let's get some of this yellow in here. And I'm just going to cover up some of that area. Now I can come back in here with an oil pastel. I can come back in with, if y'all are familiar with pan pastels, they're a lot of fun to color this kind of thing. Now I'm using ink, which will be permanent. And that way when it's dry, I can go back over top of this with more water or more ink and it won't lift the paint that's underneath there. Let's put a little bit more shadow in here. So I'm grabbing a little bit more water and using that dark color that I created. And let's just drop in a little shadow. So really, this is just messing around, practice, create. Besides using a small piece of paper like this, that is already cut to ATC size, I often will work on a large piece of paper. I'll just use a pencil to mark the 2.5. So this is 2.5 inches by 3.5 inches size. And then I'm working on multiples at the same time. And usually I do that on watercolor paper. All right, we're done with that layer. We'll come back to that in just a minute. It is important because these inks are permanent inks that you go ahead and wipe them out of your palette while they're still wet. I'm going to set this aside and use just plain water and spray it in here to keep them juicy. As I'm painting, also, if I notice that they are starting to dry out, I will do that as well. Spray just a little bit of water on it because what happens is when they get dry, they will get all crusty. It's not that they won't come out of your ceramic palette. And the reason that I'm using a ceramic palette is so that I can get them out. But you're going to see they're getting a little bit crusty here, right? So definitely you want to get those cleaned out before they completely dry in there. Because this is ceramic, you can use alcohol on it. So if the paint gets hard in there, I have a little spray bottle that I keep alcohol in, like this, and I spray it, and then that will lift out. That'll help to lift out those bits of the paint that get left behind. After I wipe it like this, then I take it to the sink and I rinse it off, and that'll get rid of all of these little pieces that were left on my ceramic palette. But I definitely recommend the ceramic palette because if you're using a plastic palette, it can tend to stain the plastic palette. Let's see, because there are a few little bits right here. Let's spray it with a little bit of alcohol. And then you'll find that those should lift right out. Yes. And then wash it. Here's what I'm going to use to do some collage on this artist trading card now that the inks are dry. And remember, the inks are permanent, so they should not lift back up. We're going to be using the Pebbio Studio Acrylic Gel Medium. This is acrylic paint with no color in it. So it has the texture of acrylic paint, but it can act like a glue, which is why I love it. You're also going to need a brush, which is kind of between stiff and not stiff. And then some sort of palette knife I usually will use. And then here are the stamp and some collage papers that I selected. I'm working on a palette paper background, so I can take this gel medium and just squeeze it right out onto the palette there. And then I can take my papers and sort of audition where I want them to go. Now, I did this a little bit earlier, so I'm going to put them in their places, the little pieces that I have here. And this one, what I want to do though, is I want to have this, a piece of this underneath there to really offset that red. So let's take a little piece off of here. I like ragged edges too. That's just me. I love to be able to show that very organic look. So let's take this, and what if we put that right there and audition those pieces like that? So we still have a little bit of our element of what we painted earlier. Now, a lot of times the painting on the background is just a way to get started. And sometimes you don't even see it anymore after I've auditioned all of my collage pieces and decided where to put them. But in this particular case, yes, we're going to preserve a little bit of that. So let's go ahead and put our pieces down. They sort of go in order from back to front. And now what I'm going to do is I can either use my palette knife. You put it on the back of the palette knife, and then we're going to put that on there. Or I could do the same thing with my brush. I tend to use the palette knife because, let me tell you, it's so easy to clean off the palette knife. I love that. Plus, you can use the palette knife to pick up your pieces like this. I love old music for this kind of thing. Now, let me mention also that the gel medium that I recommend is the matte medium. But if you have shiny paints in the background, meaning metallics, iridescence, you may not want to use a matte medium over top of it for collage elements. So you can get a gel gloss medium, and the many different brands make it. So yes, you can get a gloss medium instead of the matte medium if you want to preserve your shininess in the background. Now there's a teeny tiny little piece over here. And I'm kind of crazy when it comes to paper, as I'm sure quite a few of you are. I don't like to let little pieces go to waste. They just add a little bit more interest, especially when you're working on a mini piece of artwork. And let's go ahead. The nice thing about working on the palette pad here, it's just a shiny, it's kind of a waxy paper, but it doesn't give off wax. And the nice thing is that you can pick up some of what I just used just by doing this with the palette knife, or I could also do it with the brush. I could pick it back up. Here, I'm going to put a little bit more on the back of there. We're going to put some on there, flip it over, and then this is going to go over top of what was there. What's nice about some of these papers is they're translucent. So when they dry, when this dries, this gel medium, it's actually clear. So it looks white when it's wet, but when it's dry, it's clear. So you'll be able to see that design through that translucent paper after the fact. Now I'm going to put the red one down. Now this red one is so delicate that I can't flip it, put this gel medium on it, and then reflip it over. So what I'm going to do instead, and the beauty of having the inks, the permanent Bombay inks in the background, is that the color will not lift. If I were working on a watercolor background, that watercolor would lift right back up when I get it wet with the gel medium. Okay, let's put this up here.
This is actually just tissue paper that was white that I put fluid paint all over. There we go. And the edges of that are nice and organic. But you'll see you're not messing up your design here at all by doing that. As a matter of fact, I think I'll cover the whole thing with gel medium to seal it all in. And it won't lift any of that up. It will not lift up the ink. Beautiful. Now we're ready to put the stamp on. The stamp is a nice thick piece of paper. So I'm gonna lay it in a fresh place. And the reason is if this starts to get tacky, this gel medium, and I put a piece of paper down, sometimes when you lift it up, it can tear. So because the stamp, of course, is one of the main features of this, I don't want it to tear. There we go. Oh, yeah. It looks like it's from Czechoslovakia, the postage stamp. I love the foreign postage stamps. So here, I'll bring it up closer for you to see. So you can see the postage stamp. Some of this design is showing through the translucent paper here. There's some blank space so I can put a word if I want to there and keep building on it. All right, we're going to leave that to dry and then we're going to come back in with some of the iridescent paints. What do you do if you have some leftover gel medium on your surface? I take the tube and tap it a couple times on your table to get it down inside. Then I squeeze it to get the air out. There we go. And now I can pick it up on my palette knife and get it back into the tube by gently releasing from here, and then the air will suck it back in there because I don't like to waste anything, right? Now, once I've done that, I can do this again. That way I preserved that blob that was on here. Now I'm going to wipe this off and let's put the top back on it. You can buy gel mediums that come in big jars like this. And if you do it that way, it's of course a lot easier to get the paint back in, or to get the medium back inside the jar. And now the cleanup, if you're cleaning up from a brush, you're going to need to wipe out the gel medium on the brush and dip back and forth from your water. The less acrylic medium and colors you can put down into your water supply, the better. and then you're going to wash it off in water and take it to your sink. And then I use General's soap, a big soap block, in order to clean my brushes. But if you're using a palette knife, this is how simple it is to clean it. Oh, yeah. That's my favorite. That's why I like to use my palette knife most of the time when I'm doing collage. At this point, it is okay to use a heat tool and go ahead and warm that up. It won't hurt anything to speed it along if you want to keep going quickly, because I don't know if you're like me, I hate to wait. So it only takes a few moments of using your heat gun to get that nice and dry. All right, this is dry. Now we're going to add some highlights with Doc PH Martin's iridescent calligraphy colors. This one happens to be bronze. Let's see what it looks like. Yeah, it is well used. So let's see what the status of it is. Drip a little brush in there. Ooh, there it is. Quite beautiful. It has gotten a little thick, which means that I can put a little bit of water in there. How would I do that? I would use my dropper and put a drop or two of water in there in order to get it to be a little more fluid if it gets thick on you. You do want to mix all the mica that makes the color up inside it like that. Okay, and then we'll get this brush to a point. Now, if it were very fluid, I would use my speedball pen, dip pen, and put the ink in this small well and dip it in this way. But it looks like it's a little too thick, so I'm going to use it on a brush. Oh, the color is so beautiful. I just want to make sure I have plenty on there when I go to put it on my artist card. There we go. This is a nice brush because it comes to a point. And this is the blotting paper, so you make sure that everything is moving the way that you want it to. I like to frame my postage stamp. That's just something that I do. Of course, there may be something else that you do. You do you, right? So I'm turning the brush so I can get it. So what I'm doing here, of course, is creating a little frame around it, like that. I'll usually go over it twice. I actually need to get my brush just a little bit wet to help that to flow. Yep, just a little bit of water will help that flow. There we go. Do this again. So we've got a fun little frame around it, and it's nice and shimmery. I can highlight other parts of it if I want to as well. You can see I have plenty of paint on me, so I can get some paint on my finger. Let's put this down before I end up getting paint everywhere. And then I can run over some of the areas like this, because I find it's good to have that same sort of effect in more places than just around the stamp. All right. Ooh, there's lots there. There we go. I'm going to write a word here, so I'm going to avoid that area a little bit. But who doesn't love to get their fingers involved, right? By the time I'm done with a project, I always have paint all over me. All right, good. Good, good, good. There we go. Now we'll wait a couple of minutes for that to dry. Of course, with this, I'm going to clean it by wiping it down first, and then dipping it in water, getting as much color off as I can before swishing it in the water. And if a little bit of paint gets stuck on here like this, I'm going to use alcohol, as I showed you earlier, to spray on there and take it off. Now we're at the last stage for me, which is writing a word on the card. And I use the Pigma Micron Pens. And there's also a Pigma graphic pen. The size is on the tip. I like these because they're permanent when you use them. You can even write with them underneath your collage, and they will stay permanent just like the Bombay inks do. Now, I do like to practice different ways of writing on just a piece of paper, leftovers from some of my other work, before I write on there. So I selected this one right here that I'm going to put on here, and I'm putting the word slay on here because if you look closely at the postage stamp, this is a person on a horse slaying a small dragon. So we're going to put the word slay on there. I'm going to use the graphic one Sakura Pigma marker. And I know how I want to write that. And then that way it matches a little bit of the print that's in here. So that's slay. Of course, it can mean many different things. In this case, slay as in do it well, right? All right. This one here, I was messing around with a different kind of font, and that is because the font that's in that gorgeous postage stamp is a little old world, so I'm going to follow along with that. Let's use this little bit smaller one, which is the 05, and we will write wisdom right across here. Now, I do want to show you this is the nickel. Earlier, I had shown you the bronze for the frame here, and this is the iridescent nickel that gives you a beautiful, subtle shimmer background on this one. And we're going to write the word wisdom right here. There you go. There's the word wisdom. Now, I can go back later and thicken these up a little bit and put in drop shadows, but that way you can customize your cards with your Micron pens.
If you've made it this far in the video, thanks for joining me for how to make an artist trading card like this. Slay. Yes, so I'd love to see you on my next video. Please subscribe and stay artsy.